I welcome you to the fourth unit of our governance formation program entitled Catholic Social Teaching, Principles for Right Living. I am Sister Lois Eckes, a member of the Monastery of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, and it's a privilege to take big leaps through this unit of formation with you. St. Benedict says in his prologue, actually in verse 4, that before you begin a good work, that it is very important to begin with prayer. And so we know that what we're about is very good and holy work. So I invite you to take your unit of formation that you have, your study guide, and you could pray this prayer with me. Loving and gracious God, we thank you for the great gift that is Catholic social teaching. As we learn about these principles, keep us ever mindful of the needs of those around us. Show us how to best minister to our sisters and brothers who are in need. May we honor through both word and deed the inherent dignity that is already theirs. God of justice and goodness, in you we find our identity and mission. Renew in us a recognition of the call we have received as your daughters and sons, that we might cooperate with you in your work of restoring our world. Loving God, touch tenderly the wounds of our world. Help us to comfort those whom the world has forgotten and protect all those whom the world has rejected. We ask this in the name of Jesus through the working of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we look at our Catholic social teaching principles for right living, we really want to be aware that, of course, all of this flows from the divine community of love, which we of course call the whole Blessed Trinity. And then the Word, the second person, coming into the world as one of us and living, being a living embodiment of the Catholic social teaching. And of course, all of this is rooted, as from our triune God, in the scriptures, the Hebrew tradition, the Hebrew scriptures, which we call the Old Testament, and then the Christian tradition, which we call the New Testament. And the whole sacred scripture, the body of sacred scripture, is full of references to all these themes that we're going to leap through very quickly here and that you're going to study more carefully with a wonderful schema that you have here. But the prophets, the Psalms, certainly the Gospels, I have so many references to the Catholic social teaching, and in fact, that's where we get our Catholic social teaching from. And Jim Wallace once did an experiment with a friend of his. He took an old Bible, he took out all the pages that referred to social justice or Catholic social teaching, and he said in the end he had about this much of the Bible left, which tells us how embedded in the scriptures is our Catholic social teaching. And then, of course, we move into the papal, conciliar, and episcopal documents, the Catechism of the Church. And I don't have time to go into the examples of that here, but you have those in your study guide. And then all the witnesses throughout history of how people have lived the Catholic social teaching. We all have our favorite people, and I won't begin to name them for myself, but you reflect on that and think of the people that emulate them as you learn more about our themes here. Also, I'd like to say as we move forward here that in your guide, there are 9 of them named, but I'm using the schema from the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, which identifies 7. And in this presentation, all 9 of the elements that are named in your guide are embedded in these 7 elements as well. So the first one is the life and dignity of the human person. And of course, this theme or this element of Catholic social teaching is its foundation. Human life is sacred. All life is sacred from conception to providential end. And therefore, everyone has intrinsic dignity worthy of respect, protection, and care. And it's been said that the measure of a society's moral integrity is how well it cares for human life, it cares for the vulnerable and those especially in need. Well, all right, then our second theme at the heart of Catholic social teaching is call to family, community, and participation. Within our global culture, afflicted by excessive individualism, the second key theme is so important more than ever. The family is a central social body, needing strong support in every possible way. And we can only grow into the fullness of our life potential in healthy communities where together we seek the common good and the well-being of all, especially those who are poor and vulnerable. All right, let's move right now then to a key, the third theme, which is the rights and responsibilities. Human rights are to be protected and responsibilities are to be met. Right to life and everything required for human dignity, like a safe place to live, food, shelter, clothing, opportunities for education, so that a person can fully flower into the person that they're meant to be. That's all part of what we're talking about here. Our responsibility to one another, for our families, to the larger community, includes advocating for those whose basic needs are not being met, and respecting the other who may be different, remembering that they too are made in the image and likeness of God. And of course, working together for open communication, decision making, that is based on listening with the ear of our heart. As you know, that's one of my favorite lines from the Rule of Saint Benedict. All right, then our next key theme is option for the poor and vulnerable. As I said above, the moral test of any society is how well it respects the dignity of every person and cares for its most vulnerable members. Remember the teaching of Jesus in Matthew 25, what we will be judged on at the end of our life. It's all here. And then our willingness to be educated on global, social, economic, and ecological issues and get involved in resolving them. And hopefully we're all doing that to the best of our ability. Then our fifth theme is the dignity of work and the rights of workers. First of all, we need to see work as a participation in God's work of creation, not a drudgery, but a right and a privilege. Work has or is to have great dignity. Therefore, it must be meaningful, life-giving. There must be just wages, safe working conditions, and then the right to organize, to take initiative for economic security and well-being, including the right to own property. And all of this is fleshed out more fully in your guide. Then our sixth theme is solidarity. A huge privilege is to see ourselves as one with and not separate from other people, or the rest of creation for that matter, on every level, locally, nationally, and globally. We're one family, no matter what our race is, our nationality, our ethnic background, all our differences, they don't matter. It's diversity, but unity is what we are all called to honor here. And we're called to honor the common good with all its global dimensions, to see ourselves as part of an independent world. And then, of course, this flows into our commitment to justice and to peace. Justice which empowers others, advocates policies that are fair to people that are impacted by them, and then that frees them to be their best selves. Then peace that finds ways to dialogue and to bring healing to our world and birth to a vision that builds and fashions a way full of life for all our human and cosmic family. And then our last theme, stewardship of creation. God has entrusted us with the great work of protecting our earth home and all her resources, and of seeing ourselves as part of the sacred web of life, the web of all creation, which continues to evolve into its fullness in Christ Jesus. It calls for great care of all our resources, treating them, as Saint Benedict says in chapter 31, as if they were sacred vessels of the altar. Mindful, we need to be of reverent care for all people, including ourselves, and all our time and our talents, our finances, and so on. All is gift to be shared and treated with reverence and deep gratitude. A most excellent resource to help deepen our personal commitment and appreciation for stewardship of creation is, of course, Pope Francis's beautiful encyclical Laudato Si. I'm assuming that some of us, maybe most of us, have already read it. If not, I really encourage you to do so. And as you do so, just be mindful of these seven themes or elements of Catholic social teaching that are woven through them, through this book. And also, if you have read it, you might want to just kind of revisit it with this point of view in mind. I'd like to end with a prayer or a blessing. And it again, it's found in this book, Laudato Si. It's Pope Francis's blessing. And be mindful as you're listening to it of how, again, it weaves in all the themes that we have just skipped over like deer. So let us pray. All-powerful God, you are present in the whole universe and in the smallest of your creatures. You embrace with your tenderness all that exists. Pour out upon us the power of your love that we may protect life and beauty. Fill us with peace that we may live as brothers and sisters, harming no one. O God of the poor, help us to rescue the abandoned and forgotten on this earth, so precious in your eyes. Bring healing to our lives that we may protect the world and not prey on it, that we may sow beauty, not pollution and destruction. Touch the hearts of those who look only for gain at the expense of the poor and the earth. Teach us to discover the worth of each thing, to be filled with awe and contemplation, to recognize that we are profoundly united with every creature as we journey toward your infinite light. We ask you to be with us each day and encourage us, we pray, in our struggle for justice, love, and peace. Amen. I thank you for joining me for this overview of Unit 4 of our governance formation, and let us pray together that we will all learn to appreciate and understand and embody and integrate and live our Catholic social teaching, those principles for right living, which are so beautiful and so essential for our lives and for the lives of our beautiful world and cosmos. Thank you very much. God's richest blessings be yours.